You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America Pack. He writes the Down with Tyranny blog, and he turned us all on to Randy Bryce. And he joins us from, where is it again? Hollywood, Los Angeles, Laguna Hills. Where is it that you live?
Los Feliz.
Los Feliz. I love Randy Bryce.
Everyone loves Randy. Randy is such an authentic guy. People think he's the greatest.
He's the real deal. And I asked some tough questions. I didn't go for his story. Now I feel guilty because I decided I was going to ask him tough questions about issues and stuff.
Good. I'm glad you did.
And he's a better man than I am. I have no right to ask him these tough questions, but he does.
Good job to ask him tough questions. What are you talking about?
I thought he did a great job. I thought he was fantastic, and he's sincere, and his heart is in the right place, and he's the real deal. I didn't touch on his story at all. That's one thing I just, I don't know. I think the story is amazing, but Paul Ryan has a story of, you know, at the age of 16, walking into a room and seeing his dead father and then having to move in with some relatives, and his grandmother came to live with him, and she had Alzheimer's disease, and if it weren't for Social Security,
the difference is that Paul Ryan then turned around and pulled the ladder up after him, and all of the benefits that he got from health insurance and other types of help from Social Security to make up for his loss, he doesn't want anyone else to have that. And that's the exact opposite of Randy Bryce. I mean, Randy wants to expand those benefits for the whole country. Ryan wants to end them. Ryan, you know, wouldn't have gone to college if not for government help. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't want people who follow him to get that help. So that's the basic difference between Democrats and Republicans, for one thing, but between someone like Randy and someone like Ryan.
There's nobody more delusional than someone who calls himself a self-made man. I would assume Paul Ryan believes that he did it all by himself. Nobody does it by themselves. Nobody.
Right. Nobody. And I think Paul Ryan knows that. I mean, he was a fitness instructor when he got picked up by a bunch of wealthy Republicans who said, we can turn you into a congressman.
And that's really
and
how,
they did.
And that's how it, and that's really is how it works. New Orleans, the Huey Long story that they turned into a novel. Sean Penn played him, Broderick Crawford, all the King's Men.
Yes, all the King's Men.
They really do come to somebody who's working class, and they say, we can make you the governor. If you just do what we tell you. Yeah.
And that's Ryan. That's the story of Paul Ryan. I mean, literally, before he was working as a fitness instructor, he was driving a Wienermobile. So this big sort of that was shaped like a hot dog and a bun, and he was driving it and selling wieners.
Yeah. So he's shameless, in other words. If you would drive a Wienermobile around town, you've already lost your pride. You've sold out to Oscar Mayer.
He's worked on what he's doing now.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, even, I mean, I've been broke, but I would never drive a Wienermobile. Well, what would you like to talk about, sir? Here's the problem I have right now. I feel guilty because I asked Randy really tough questions. And I didn't get personal with him.
Don't feel guilty. He needs that. He's going to get a lot tougher questions as time goes on, so he needs to practice.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Don't feel guilty at all. It's good that you did that.
Because tell the audience his story, and now my audience is going to hate me, the ones who don't know his story. Tell his life story.
I suggest everyone who's listening to us now go to the go to YouTube and watch his video. The announcement video tells his life story, and it's about his relationship with his parents, his son. And as what he does for a living, I mean, which I'm sure you talked about, he's an iron worker, he's a union activist, he's a regular stand-up guy. He happens to also be very intelligent as a regular stand-up guy. And now he's running against the Speaker of the House, and in a race where the Democratic Party, the DCCC, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, had said, that Wisconsin will not be contested. They laid down the law. No, there will be no Democratic races in Wisconsin. Now they're begging Randy to allow them to endorse him.
Is that happening? Because last time you were on the show, you said that...
I've already said too much. I shouldn't have even said what I just said. I'm sorry I did it. Don't ask me about it again.
Okay, last time you were... I'm not going to ask you, but last time you were on the show, a week ago, you said that Randy Bryce was not getting the endorsement quite yet from the DCCC, that their recruitment committee had seen a video and they fell in love with him, but it still remains to be seen whether or not Nancy Pelosi will put the full faith and credit of the Democratic Party behind Randy Bryce. I did speak to him. He was in Washington, D.C.
Yes. Not seeing them, though.
Okay.
He's seeing, I'm not supposed to say who he's seeing, but he's seeing, just think of this. Who do I think is the greatest politician in America? Don't guess. I'm just saying it. He's seeing that guy.
Okay. All right.
I feel like I'm giving away things I'm not supposed to be talking about. Let's talk about something else.
Okay.
I shouldn't be talking about inside information that I happen to have for one reason or another. Let's talk about other things.
All right. I want to ask you about Nancy Pelosi, and has nothing to do with Randy Bryce.
All right.
When I was talking to Randy, we talked about the Gingrich wave, that the first Speaker of the House since 1862 to get thrown out, to lose an election, was Tom Foley. He was the Democratic Speaker of the House, and he lost his seat in 1994. To a guy, another cutter, I don't know who it was, but then
cut.
Yeah, and then Gingrich became Speaker. Well, that was a major sea change, and it was the Gingrich Revolution, the contract with America. He had excited the populace. Not since 1954 had the Republicans had the House. Gingrich led the charge. In order for the Democrats to take back the House, there has to be a Pelosi revolution?
No, you can't have an analogy there. You know, remember in 2006 when Pelosi did take back the House from Jenny Hastert, it was very exciting. It was the first woman. I mean, you know, a lot of Americans think, wow, that was a big deal. First woman speaker in history, also the first California speaker in history, which was a big deal for some people. Also the first Italian-American, which was a big deal for other people. But I think generally when you want to talk about history, you're not talking about Italian-Americans or Californians. You're talking about the first woman speaker. That was a gigantic thing to happen. I mean, think of every woman in the country, every girl yet to be born. Can now say that can live in a world where that ceiling is already broken.
Well,
we owe that to Nancy.
Well, Newt Gingrich didn't break any ceilings, but he broke a couple of couches. He's very heavy. And what about Dennis Hastert? How many wrestling coaches out there didn't think they could become Speaker of the House? How many wrestling coaches did he inspire?
How many wrestling who were having sex with their underage trainees.
I'm sorry. What did you say? What did you say?
You were just trying to figure out a way how to get me to talk about that.
But I didn't hear what you said. You broke up.
Oh, I said that how many wrestling coaches who were having sex with their underage trainees were thinking that now they could also become a speaker.
So he was a he was an inspiration to, well, mostly Republicans. All right. Let's talk about the health care bill.
Okay. All right. Well, I mean, the aspect that I was writing about today, which is, I assume, is what you want to talk
sure.
about, was is the, you know, what the whole idea of single payer or Medicare for all, what that means to people. So a majority of Americans now see that as the path forward, Medicare for all. There's a bill out there now that basically has been out there since Truman was president, but it's gaining rapidly. And there are now a majority of Democrats in the House who have signed onto this bill as co-sponsors. If I remember correctly, there are now 115 Democrats who have signed on as co-sponsors. This is a bill that John Conyers wrote this time. Bernie is writing one for the Senate that's going to be out in a couple of weeks, I understand. But Nita Lowey from New York, a Pelosi ally, signed on to this bill last week, she being the 115th person. So when it started, there were 52, if you include Conyers, who wrote it. So 52 Democrats, almost all progressives, were behind it. Now, even the most corrupt conservative Democrats, like, you know, people like Lou Correa and Greg Meeks and even Joe Crowley, even these kind of Democrats who don't believe in things like single payer, even they're signing it now because Democrats have to. The problem that I'm finding is when I talk with people about how the Democrats are behind single payer and behind Medicare for all, what people are saying to me now is, oh, yeah, sure. Just like California, all those politicians in California in the legislature who campaigned on single payer, and then they get a chance where they have a Democratic, overwhelming Democratic majority in the Assembly, overwhelming Democratic majority in the Senate, and they have a Democratic governor. So they've got everything they need to pass it. And what do? The Senate passed it. The state Senate passed Medicare for all. And then the Assembly got nervous. Brown said, do not let this go on my desk. I don't want this as part of my legacy, meaning vetoing it. And then the Assembly Speaker, Anthony Rendon, just betrayed Democratic voters completely and killed the bill. So it won't even get voted on.
Well, David, I have to just...
I know what he said.
And
Correct, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that he's right, because that's what the government should be doing now. The Democratic controlled government. It wasn't a Democratic controlled government back in those days, but now it is, and they should be making it work. That's what they're hired to do. I'm not saying it's necessarily easy, but you know they're in charge. They can make it work.
Let me clarify just for a second. We had David Dayan on about 2 weeks ago, and he said the press wasn't reporting the defeat of Medicare for All in California properly. He said that Rendon, the assembly leader, could only do so much, but then it had to be taken to the people. There had to be an initiative at the ballot box in order for the...
Rendon didn't do anything except kill it.
I'm sorry?
So, in other words, Senate passed it. Rendon could have passed it too. And then whatever the next step is, and I don't know that David is 100% right what the next step is, but yes, there has to be a next step. And maybe it was going to the ballot box. Okay, fine. Let's go to the ballot box. But instead, Rendon just killed the bill. So most Democrats who I talk to now, most activists, are basically saying they're not interested in what Democrats have to say anymore about this because they don't believe them, and they'll believe it when Rendon gets primaried, or they'll believe it when the Democrats in the Assembly, in the California State Assembly, vote him out of the speakership. Rendon is now, you know, one of many public enemies, number one.
Okay, so when Hillary Care was being introduced back in 93, which Gingrich can attribute much of his success, much of the Gingrich wave was because of Hillary Care, she cited Kaiser Permanente as the template upon which Hillary Care would work. And Kaiser Permanente...
Can you explain to me or to anybody what Hillary Care meant? I mean, that's part of the problem with Hillary Care and Obamacare. No one knows what the hell those things even are.
Well, yes, let me ask my question.
And what the Republicans want, but the problem is that no one understood them. So they couldn't get people behind it because people didn't know what the hell they were.
Right. But they were saying,
why wasn't Hillary just trying to do what Truman said should be done, which was just expand Medicare? Everyone loves Medicare. Everybody understands it. They know what it means. It's pretty simple. How about just expand Medicare? If you can't do Medicare for all or in one shot, if that's too much to do, then how about making it, instead of 65, make it 50? Make it 45. You know, just expand until everyone has Medicare. That would be understandable. But these crappy ideas of Hillary Care and Obamacare, no one the hell understands what it even means. That's why those bills weren't important. And yes, they're better than what came before, but, you know, when the Republicans complain about a bill that's 8,000 pages, people say, yeah, that's right. Well, I don't know what it means.
Right. So my question is, I would assume that Kaiser Permanente thinks very highly of itself in California, and I would assume Jerry Brown and Assembly Leader Rend and a lot of politicians in California, Democratic politicians, are in the pocket of health insurance lobbyists. Is that a fair assumption?
Well, they're in the pocket of a lot of special interests. That's one of them.
But is it fair to say that people like Kaiser Permanente, wouldn't they go out of business? Wouldn't a lot of these health insurance companies go out of business in California if California introduces single payer?
There will definitely be some health insurance companies that have a hard time, yeah.
Okay, so what are the are you making tea, coffee? What are you doing?
I had a, you don't want to hear what I'm doing.
Okay.
But let me just tell you, I had a particle of a nut stuck between my teeth, and I was getting that.
You got to, Howie, how many times do I have to tell you, you got to get those nuts out of your mouth? Now, here's the point I'm making. And I said this to Randy Bryce, and I had a little courage when I said it. In order for us to get Medicare for all, we have to declare war on the health insurance companies. That we need an enemy. You know, we're able to pass the Patriot Act, a war authorization, when we go to war. We need an enemy. The American people need a villain. Osama bin Laden, Saddam Hussein. We're looking for a scapegoat. And we have to frame this as war. We're being killed by health insurance.
Isn't that what Trump is for? I mean, is there a better villain anywhere than Trump? How about Ryan? I mean, Ryan and McConnell, they're like cartoon character class villains.
But they're the fronts for the health insurance people.
Yes, they are.
So why don't we declare war? You know, nothing we do goes well. We're a country that can't do anything except declare war against something. So let's declare.
What I was saying, I read off a list of names to you earlier of people who had signed on to the Medicare for All bill, who I said are untrustworthy supporters of that bill. And basically, those are people who are taking payoffs from the insurance company. So
right.
A normal person would say they're taking bribes, but since the legislature gets to determine what a bribe is, they define it in the law, then they're not bribes. But any sensible person who would see, you know, Joe Crowley has taken X number of dollars from the health insurance industry, and then he protects their interests in committees. To me, that's a bribe. In any case, the point that I was making is, yes, you are not going to get sitting politicians to go up against the health industry because the health industry pays them off. It's that simple.
So we have to declare war on health. I'm sorry?
They pay off Republicans and they pay off Democrats.
So
they pay off Republicans much more,
but they pay off Democrats too. And I don't mean a little. They pay, you know, if they're giving, you know, $2 billion to Republicans, they're giving $1 billion to Democrats. It's a big amount.
Okay, so I'm calming down. I'm asking you this question. You're a Democratic populist progressive operative. You deal with all the great Democratic candidates and all the progressive candidates.
I'm a little queasy about saying Democrat, but yes, they are Democrats. I don't deal with the Democratic Party. I deal with progressives, not with Democrats.
Okay. Why are we not demonizing and name-checking these health insurance executives? Why aren't we making them the enemy? They are the enemy. There's no question that they are murderers. Why?
Do you not hear Bernie Sanders doing that all the time?
I don't think we're salivating over the prospect of putting entire industries out of business. I think
it's not a matter of putting entire industries out of business. It's a matter of a changing economy and a changing way we do business. And no one's putting entire industries out of business, and I'm sure that they won't. And there are a lot of political leaders on the Democratic side who are actually saying that hey, we have to, you know, go slow with this Medicare for all. We have to make sure that we don't put a lot of innocent people out of business, and we have to work it out so that it makes sense. So let them do it. Let them work it out, not sit around and twiddle their thumbs.
Wait, you sound like an incrementalist, Howie Klein.
I'm not being an incrementalist at all. I'm saying if it can't happen in a week, let it happen in a year. And let's work it out so that, you know, I'm trying to remember who I was with who said this. I don't remember who it was. But, oh, yeah, one of my neighbors said, let them go work for Uber. I don't know that I would do that. But, you know, maybe job retraining is the way to go. I mean, if they're doing a function that isn't needed by society anymore, then, you know, sorry, you made the wrong choice in industry.
Wait a second. Are you're giving sympathy to anybody who works for a health insurance company?
No, that's not what I'm doing. I'm doing the opposite. I'm saying they're working for an industry that isn't serving a social purpose anymore. It's doing the opposite. It's a dysfunction, and we shouldn't be propping it up.
But I can't believe how gentle you are. It's not that they're doing the opposite.
If they were hearing the same thing that you're hearing, I don't think they would think I'm being gentle. I think that they would want to hire an assassin to kill me.
Wait a second. You're saying that people who work for health insurance companies don't provide a service, a function. I'm saying they're murderers. I'm saying they've killed more people than Osama bin Laden.
Okay, so then why do you feel sorry for them?
I don't. I'm saying why are you trying to understand their plight? Just put them out of business.
Well, I mean, look, when it comes to the executives at the top who are making the kind of money that they're making, I agree. So when Bernie talks about the, you know, multimillionaires who run these giant operations, I agree with him completely that they should just dump them like tomorrow. But on the other hand, there are thousands and thousands of other people who as a decent society, we should try to think of a way to ease their change in status.
I want to help them. I just need them to fill out some more paperwork. That's all I need them to do. I'll help them get jobs, but I lost their driver's license. So the point I'm making is that I believe in collective guilt. I do. And I think it's not good enough just to blame the corporate CEOs. You got to blame the people who are shuffling the papers down below, who aren't being whistleblowers, through passivity are letting people get denied health care. And then they go home. It's the banality of evil. You have to blame everybody. If you go work for a health insurance company, you're part of the problem. You're not working within the system trying to fix it. You're keeping your mouth shut. You're denying claims, and people are dying because of you. You're a murderer.
Well, not everybody has a function in that business of denying claims. There are some people who aren't doing that.
look, it's we don't need to make more problems. We need to fix a problem, and one of the ways to fix a problem is could be, for example, let's offer retraining to everyone who loses their job.
Who cares if they lose their job? People are losing their life, but they're
people. And lots of other people do as well, and there's no reason that we need to displace them. I mean, look, you would say that these horrible trade policies merit retraining when workers are put out of work, right?
Yeah.
And I would say the same thing. If we do wind up going with Medicare for All, and a certain number of people lose their jobs because of it, let the government pay for retraining for them.
You know,
I'm willing to pay taxes for that.
Would you agree that Wall Street, that Bernie is right about Wall Street being an entire sector built on fraud, that all of Wall Street, like 99% of what Wall Street does, is fraud?
I don't know what the percent is, but I know what you're getting at, and the answer is yes, I agree.
If you're a stockbroker, you're a con artist. You're lying. If you're a hedge fund manager, you're a con artist because you can't outperform the market. You can't predict the future. So an entire segment of our economy is just a con job.
What am I doing on a radio show with a communist like you?
I'm not a communist. I'm saying so at the height of the Great Recession, a former friend of mine said, I agree with you that stockbrokers and Wall Street is fraudulent. I agree with Bernie, but they need to work. They need to make money. And I screamed at
them. Well, let them get honest work.
Exactly. F them. They're thieves. F
them. No, not F them. Let them get honest work.
They're not. No, you know what? They're sociopaths. They don't know what
honest
work. Some of
them.
They should be. I don't want to tell you.
The ones who have broken the law should be in jail. But they're not all. You can't tar
all of them. All of them.
In the industry that way.
All of them. They're liars. Every single. If you're a stockbroker, you're a liar. You're a liar. At least a croupier, at least a blackjack dealer, tells you. You know you're probably going to lose, and I hope you do.
You don't hear the sound right now, but. MSNBC is on right now, and the guy who's talking, I don't hear what he's saying, is Jim Himes. So he's a Democrat from Connecticut who ran as a progressive when he first ran, but he had been a stockbroker and a Wall Street guy, and he's now one of the heads of the New Dems. And in his mind, he's not just representing the people in his district in Connecticut. He's representing Wall Street. He's their guy. He takes, I don't know, approximately $1 million a year from the finance sector, and votes consistently to give them special favors and special deals. And I'm just as you're talking, I'm looking at this guy and seething.
Why aren't we doing class warfare in this country? He'll demonize the welfare queens. He's the one, you know. The new Dems will say, well, you know, Medicare is important, and Medicaid is important, food stamps are important, but we don't want to get crazy. We got to watch for fraud here. We got to watch for food stamp fraud. They'll demonize poor people. Where are we? Why aren't we demonizing all these people? Why aren't we demonizing the health insurance CEOs and anybody who works for? All right,
I'm on the phone with somebody that's making me look like a conservative.
It's your fault, Klein. First it was you, then you introduced me to Alan Grayson, and now Randy Bryce. It seems like you've all right. So what's going to happen with the health care bill?
It's a crystal ball I don't have, but it looks like, McCain seems to be doing a wily thing. He's never going to vote against it. He could, but he's not going to vote against it. But instead, he's staying away, and I think they're losing votes as he stays away. I think McConnell thought he could pass it today, or at least pass Cruz's horrible amendment today. But I think by McCain claiming he's too sick to come into Washington, you know, and if they're going to win it, they're only going to win by one vote. That they can't do anything right now. I don't know what's going to happen. Of course, no one does. I don't think McConnell knows what's going to happen. But my count is different from the public count. I mean, I know for a fact that what's her name, Capito, Shelley Moore Capito in West Virginia, said. I don't have the exact words that she said, but she said, "I'm willing to be the vote that decides that will. I'm willing to vote no, and I'm willing to be the deciding vote that goes no." So there are two Republicans who already said no. That means that would be a tie. However, Pence could break that tie, so there needs to be a third Republican. Capito said publicly that she's willing to be that third person. So that means it's over. So what are they doing? I don't know what they're doing.
By last,
did they bribe her into voting yes? Maybe, but I don't. I haven't heard her say that. The last thing I heard her say is she's willing to be the one that kills it.
What is worse for the Republicans? Passing this health care bill or not passing it in terms of...
Well, that's a good question. And the reason it's a good question is because either one of those things is catastrophic for them. So I think that what they're trying to do now is figure out a way to make it look like they did everything they could to pass it and then don't pass it. If it passes, I think that they're going to lose like immense numbers of seats. If they don't pass it, that's going to leave a lot of Republicans pissed off and angry with them. But what are they going to do? They're not going to vote for a Democrat. Some of them will stay home, I guess. Maybe there'll be a couple of primaries here and there. But I think the worst thing for the Republicans is if they pass this bill, and I think they've come to that conclusion as well as a party. You know, some of them. Maybe don't, because some of the ones, like especially in, you know, extremely red states in the South, you know, where people are still brainwashed. But I think most Republicans have come to the conclusion that if they pass this health care bill, they're dead.
Okay.
That party's going to go down in flames.
My last question is, can you run in 2018? Can Pelosi run on impeaching Trump? I say no. I don't think you can run.
Well, she agrees with you. She says the same thing.
Right? You have to be for something, not against. Right?
Well, yes. I mean, there was a poll that came out over the weekend that showed that, you know, Donald Trump is incredibly unpopular, the most unpopular president 6 months into his term in 70 years. But then it's when the Democrats don't go to get so overjoyed because the majority of Americans think you don't stand for anything except being anti-Trump and they don't like that. So, yes, Democrats have to be for something. Guess what? That's where Bernie comes in. He is for something. He has a platform. I've been going through county by county across the country about what the votes were, and it shocked me what I was finding in all these. So let's take it like this. So counties that voted for Obama in 2012, the last time Obama ran. So we're talking about counties that voted for him that then flipped Trump, voted for Trump. So Bernie. In the counties that Bernie won in the primary, many of those counties, Bernie had far more votes in the primary, not just than Hillary did. He had far more votes than Trump did. So in other words, what I'm trying to say is some of these desperate workers said they're fed up with the status quo. They don't want anything to do with Hillary. And that's why they voted for Bernie in the primary. But then when it came to the general election and there was no Bernie, then they went for Trump. Mm. Reluctantly, they, you know, I think a lot of us judged Trump as the greater evil than Hillary. A lot of us were reluctant to vote for her, but maybe did vote for her as the lesser of two evils. Well, a lot of people voted for Trump because they thought he was the lesser of two evils. But the fact of the matter is, in county after county after county, that you would say is these are just red hell holes. Nobody cares. These people are crazy and have horrible. You may have horrible things to say about the kind of people in these counties. They voted for Bernie more than they voted for Trump. Bernie beat Trump. He wasn't running against Trump. He was running against Hillary. But it was the same day. People had to decide that day, are they going to vote for Trump? Are they going to vote for Cruz? Are they going to vote for Hillary? Are they going to vote for Bernie? And Bernie won, sometimes by massive numbers. Like, I don't remember which county it was, but I was looking at one. And remember, this is the county that Obama won and then Trump won. But in the primary, Bernie had something like 20,000 votes, and Trump had something like 6,000 votes.
So you're saying, wow, thank you for this. You're saying that Bernie can be the deciding factor in 2018 if he hits those districts and campaigns.
He's doing it, I mean, if he's doing that, he's out every weekend doing that. He's going to these districts in Pennsylvania and Ohio and West Virginia. He's been to West Virginia twice already, and he's going to count. He's not going to random places. He's going to the counties I'm talking about. He's going to counties that are Trump country that he won in the primary, and in some of them, counties that he beat Trump in by big numbers. These people just wanted no more status quo. That's what they wanted. The status quo hasn't worked for them and their families, and they wanted something else. Bernie was their first choice. When they couldn't get him, they looked at Hillary and they looked at Bernie they looked at Hillary and they looked at Trump, and they said, who's going to be against the status quo? And they said Trump. They were wrong, but that's what they thought. And I think at this point, though, also from polling, you're getting the buyer's remorse in these counties that I'm talking about is mammoth, and then they're not going to vote for Trump again.
This is really interesting because the real
winner. I'm writing about it on my blog.
I know the real winner of 2016 is Bernie.
The real winner is Trump. He's the president.
Well, and it's an interesting...
Oh, let's put it like this. The real winner, let's face it, is Putin.
Yes. So Bernie isn't going away. He's not going to run for president again.
What? Oh, is that? Is it really? You know? Well, I'm going to see him in a couple of weeks. I'll ask him. I promise.
Well, I mean, conventional wisdom is that he's too old. But that, you know, Reagan was 70 when he got in, but that was 1980.
It's not a matter of how old he is. It's a matter of how he functions. I mean, you want to talk about too old. How about Steny Hoyer and Nancy Pelosi? I was looking for something to read to you. It was this quote that someone did about what the Democratic Party leadership has turned into, and basically they very, very elegantly describe a geriatric home. I'm gonna find that quote, and next week when we talk, okay, I'll read it. You'll be hysterical laughing.
Last question.
You had a last question.
I know.
I'm missing Hayes' whole show. He's not on tonight, so I don't care that much.
Who are you missing?
Chris Hayes, my favorite guy on TV, but he's not on tonight. There's a substitute.
The land deal. This is politically motivated. Bernie Sanders' wife was the president of a college, and she allegedly defrauded the archdiocese.
It's complete bullshit. So this is bullshit that the head of Trump's campaign for Vermont started. He got this going. There's no basis in fact at all. And the person who's pushing it now, I've been told, I don't have firsthand knowledge of this, what I'm about to say, and I haven't even written about it on my blog, but a pretty high up political operative called me, you know, a guy who knows every in and out of New Jersey politics, called me up and said, this is all Cory Booker. He's the one that's keeping this bullshit story alive.
Cory Booker is a Democrat and a tool of Wall Street.
Yes, and he's trying to keep the story alive so that to knock Bernie out of the presidential race. He's trying to smear up Bernie because he wants to run for president himself. Now, I don't know that that's true, but the person who told me has never once told me anything that didn't turn out to be true, ever.
I'm going to let you go. I used to love Cory Booker when he was mayor of Newark. He was such a brave man. Howie Klein, founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. He writes the Down with Tyranny. My sister, by the way, loves Down with Tyranny.
Great. Oh, by the way, can you mention this to your audience that if they liked listening to Randy Bryce today when you interviewed him. They can donate to his campaign at Down With Tyranny. We have a an Act Blue page, and they can just go on there and give him, whether they give him $1 or $10 or $20, it's very, very much appreciated by him.
Can you say that again? You were breaking up.
So on, if they go to Down With Tyranny, my blog, there's a bar in the upper right-hand corner that says Blue America. And if they tap that bar, they'll get on a page where they can donate money, any amount of money, to Randy Bryce's campaign.
Okay, I wasn't paying attention. Can you say that again, please?
Yes. So if they want to support Randy Bryce's campaign, they can go to downwithtyranny.com. They'll see a blue horizontal bar that says Act Blue on it. They just click on that bar and they'll get right to a page where they can donate to Randy Bryce's campaign.
I think what you're saying is if people go to the Down With Tyranny blog, there's a bar that says Act Blue, a little ad, and they can click on that and then they could give money to Randy Bryce, right?
Exactly. It doesn't matter if they only can give a dollar or they can give $5 or $10, any amount is that's what a grassroots campaign is about. We don't get, you know, big $2,700 or $5,400 donations like Republicans do, but we have lots and lots of people who give $5 and $10. And that's what Randy needs to be able to beat Paul Ryan.
I see what you're saying. So people should go to Down. It was a little confusing at first, but people should go to Down With Tyranny and give fucking money to Randy Bryce. Give $5 to Randy Bryce,
yes,
because
exactly.
Paul Ryan is a piece of shit. And we got to get
that.
Well, we'll bleep it.
Okay.
All right. I'll talk to you next week. You got me all worked up this week. Thank you.
You got me crazy. You made me think that now I'm going to have to rethink all my positions. I'll talk to you next week.
You're an incrementalist, Howie. I'm kidding. Thank you.
No.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.